Let us pray. All holy and innocent child Savior, true Son of God, you have chosen to leave the glories of your heavenly kingdom in order to be born as one amongst us. The world provided no haven for your incarnation, so Mary and Joseph were forced to seek shelter at the manger. Your presence, O Lord, transformed that humble shelter for animals into the regal throne from which you would initiate the second creation of the world and the regeneration of all humanity. We bless this holy manger that protected our God and Savior from the harsh elements, and we pray this night and forevermore that our souls may be the manger in which Jesus is born anew. We pray these things in the name of the Christ child. Amen. The blessings, Almighty God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Let us pray. O Lord Jesus Christ, on this most holy of all nights, the night when God became human, it was the animals and the objects of nature which first sang your praise. As a symbol of the new creation at Christmas, we look to the evergreen tree which remained vibrant throughout the winter months, awaiting the opportunity to praise the Son of God at his birth. This night, we bless this Christmas tree and pray that we may be as vigilant in awaiting your glorious return as it was in challenging the harshness of winter so as to witness your incarnation at Bethlehem. This we ask in the name of the King of Kings, Christ our Lord. Amen. The blessings, Almighty God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And before we head over to light the Christ candle, I just want to say a special thank you to Irish Kaczynski, this year's littlest angel who brought Jesus to his manger. So thank you very much, Iris. And if you want to go back with Mom and Dad, you can head on right over there and take that off if you'd like, okay? Thank you. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. The angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and explained that Mary's child was to be born through the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. The child was to fulfill the prophecy of Isaiah, who spoke of Emmanuel, God is with us, who would come at the appointed time to save the children of God. Father, we rejoice on this sacred night as we welcome Jesus, who is the light of the world. May the coming of this light prepare us for the heavenly vision when we will see you in all your glory.
Amen.
And at this time, we will light the Christ candle, and you may be seated. We'll light the Christ candle, and then two of my acolytes will share it with the congregation for the candlelit part of the service. Throughout the Advent season, these four candles grew brighter and brighter with each passing Sunday, but it could not pass the barrier from the sanctuary proverbially out into the world. Tonight, with the incarnation, with the birth of the Son of God, we take the light from the sanctuary and we share it with all of you with the hope that you take that light out into the world.
Thank you.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy on us. Christ, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy on us. God the Father in heaven, have mercy on us. God the Son, Redeemer of the world, have mercy on us. God the Holy Spirit, have mercy on us. Holy Trinity in one God, have mercy on us. May we understand your holy will. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we realize our true relationship with you in this life and the life to come. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we continue to work with you in building your kingdom on earth. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we unite ourselves with you in the sacred mystery of the altar. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we recognize the greatness of this most holy sacrifice through which we worship you. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we feed on the bread of life, no more to hunger. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we have a share in the offering of Jesus on the cross. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we who fill our lives with your ideals be joined with you in the suffering of the Lord. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we perceive always and everywhere your all-pervading presence. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we end our days with your holy name and our hearts on our lips. Grant our prayer, Lord. Forgive our sins, O God. Grant our prayer, Lord. Cleanse and renew our hearts. Grant our prayer, Lord. Lord, bless us with the wisdom to praise you in spirit and in truth. By following your holy will, we may gain eternal salvation. Amen. I welcome you here this night to celebrate the birth, the incarnation of the very Son of God, our child Savior, Jesus of Nazareth, Jesus of Bethlehem now for a short while until his family rushes back to Nazareth to avoid the terrors of King Herod. But tonight we have only the story of innocence and joy and hope. And that is such a powerful message that people who don't even bother with the Jesus part of Christmas, they still celebrate this as something called a holiday season, because those messages that Jesus brings and shares with the world are so powerful that even people who don't really practice a Christian faith, don't even acknowledge a Christian faith, they love what this stands for. So as we gather on one of the longest nights of the year, we have light that breaks into the darkness, we have song, and I want to say a very special thank you to Mary and to Emily. That was beautiful. The choir has been practicing. Barbara's been here since like about 4 o'clock this morning. they got some beautiful hymns for you. Iris Kaczynski, she looked adorable coming over here with all that. And Santa, man, that Santa, I love that Santa. Second year in a row that Santa's taken a little break from his duties and come here to place that first present before the manger. And after Mass, if you'd like, Ellen Skrosky has put together a little book with photos from last year and a few captions. And she made me a special copy as well, and Santa has a copy too. And if you'd like to take a look at that book, I can show it to you after Mass tonight. But today is, for the church, the beginning of Christmas. I know on the 26th there's going to be after Christmas sales. I know you're probably all worn out from Christmas hymns, but today for the church is only the beginning of the celebration of this mystery. And I hope that we can take full advantage of it, because this, in a world that has so much hatred, so much violence, so much prejudice, so much everything that is bad, we need to hear this message over and over again, because this world is a good place, and most all people here are good people. And that's why Jesus comes as us. So this night, as we gather for Mass and the Feast of the Nativity, I ask all of you who will be coming forward to receive communion at this time to please make a private examination of your conscience. Feedier together. I confess to Almighty God, one and the Holy Trinity, who knows the innermost secrets of my heart, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my fault, by my own great fault. In your presence, O God, I publicly express sorrow for the many sins by which I have offended you. I resolve to amend my life, to improve and sanctify, and every henceforth to serve you faithfully all the days of my life. I ask all of those who dwell
my confession, and pray for me to our Lord God.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
May the Almighty and merciful Lord grant us pardon, absolution, and the remission of our sins.
Amen.
May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and with his authority vested in me, I absolve you from all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Show us your mercy, Lord.
And grant
us your salvation. Lord, hear our prayer.
And our
cry to you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Grant, most gracious Father, that with purity of heart, we may worthily fulfill this holy action established in remembrance of the Last Supper and the death of Jesus Christ, and for our sanctification and salvation. Be present among us, Jesus, our most perfect Master, because you said that where two or three are gathered together in my name, you are among them. We also ask, Lord, that through this holy liturgy, we may experience a spiritual revival and a better understanding of your holy will, bringing us together in one great family, guided by your commandments and by love, truth, and justice. And may we say together, let us praise the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, indivisible, revealed in body and power for all time, now, and forever.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, and the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, you make this holy night radiant with the splendor of Jesus Christ, our long-awaited Messiah. We welcome him as Lord, our life, the true life of all the world. May he bring us to eternal joy in the kingdom of heaven. We ask through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
The lesson for this Shepherd's Mass is taken from the Old Testament book of the prophet Isaiah. But there will be no gloom for those who are in anguish. In the former time, he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the latter time, he made glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond Jordan, Galilee of nations. The people who have walked in darkness have seen the great light. Those who have lived in a land of deep darkness, on them the light has shined. You have multiplied the nation, you have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as the joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burdens and the bar across their shoulders and the rod of their oppressors, you have been broken on this day of Midian. For all the boots of the trampling warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born to us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Almighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let the heavens be glad and the earth rejoice. Let the sea and what fills it resound. Let the plains be joyful and all that is in them.
Tremble before God, all the earth. Say among the nations, the Lord reigns.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Alleluia, alleluia.
I will proclaim the decree of the Lord who said to me, you are my son. Today I am your father.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Cleanse my heart and my lips, Almighty God. She cleansed the lips of the prophet Isaiah with a burning coal. In your mercy, cleanse me so I may worthy proclaim your holy gospel through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be in my heart and on my lips, that I may worthy proclaim his holy gospel. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke.
Glory be to you, Lord.
In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that the entire world should be enrolled. This was the first enrollment when Quirinius was governor of Syria. So all went to be enrolled, each to his own town. And Joseph, too, went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, the city of David that was called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and family of David, to be enrolled there with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to have her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them at the inn. Now there were shepherds in that region, living in the fields and keeping the night watch over their flock. And the angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were struck with a great fear. And the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I proclaim to you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For today, in the city of David, a Savior has been born for you who is the Messiah and the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find an infant wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was a multitude of the heavenly host with that angel praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Touches each of us emotionally, and somehow it leaves a lasting and cherished memory. Just think to yourself how many memories you have that are associated with the Christmas tree, with church, with the manger, with all that is Christmas. Somehow, this day, maybe more than any other, touches us and remains with us. It is somehow extremely personal, and at the exact same time, it is meant to be universal. It tells us that each one of us matters to God, and yet it reminds us that everyone else is also loved by God just as much as God loves me. Christmas is the revelation that I am only loved by God in the same way that some poor child, you must have seen those pictures from Aleppo, some poor child in Aleppo who maybe doesn't even know the name of Jesus, because of Christmas, God loves that child as much as he loves me. Some billionaire living in a penthouse in New York City, the person living in that billionaire's penthouse, God loves that person as much as me. It doesn't matter our circumstance in life. God isn't here to make everything perfect. But God came to say with Christmas, "I stand with each and every one of you wherever you are, and I love each of you the same." God's love is perfect. That means it doesn't come in increments. You can't have a little less perfect than perfect. Perfect is perfect, and that's all there is to it. And God loves everyone perfectly. So Christmas is most definitely a Christian feast day. But its promise is shared with all of creation without any exception. God loves us all, says the Christmas story. And I think the Christmas message is so appealing that people can celebrate without paying any attention at all to Jesus' birth. They subtract the religion but keep the idea of peace and generosity and hope and all the other good things of the season. And that's not all bad. It makes people better, if only for a season. But we here tonight, we need to remember and to still proclaim that this holiday spirit that we hear so much about, that it originates in the birth of our Savior, who was born in an animal stable because there was, according to the words of the gospel, there was simply no place for him. He was born the child of a carpenter. He was born the child of an unwed mother from Galilee. This means he belongs to all of us. This surprising, outlandish story means that no matter how much any religion thinks that they own God, and you know, because if a religion owned God, they would never come up with this story. But God comes for everybody, says Christmas, which means that nobody is ever forgotten. No one is ever so far outcast. No one is ever so far different. No one is so ever beaten and battered by this world that Christmas doesn't say to them that God loves them. This Bethlehem birth is the source of all the goodwill that we see at this time of the year, whether people celebrate Christmas with or without the baby Jesus. But at least we, here, we know that old story. We know the reason for the season. It's the power of these emotions on Christmas that make the sentimental so powerful. No matter what else happens, what will last in our memories this night are a beautiful little child dressed as an angel who brought the baby Jesus to his warm bed here in the manger. A candlelit church filled with the gentle sounds of two young girls singing the first American Christmas carol, and then that silent night or Lulaja Yazunyu, and then St. Nicholas coming here, removing his hat, making the sign of the cross, and saying a prayer before the child. And then the music that will follow this night. No matter what I say here, nobody is going to remember a year from now what I said, but you will remember Santa, you'll remember the angel, you'll remember the girls, you'll remember the music, because this is not a night for words. This is a night for feelings. Incarnation, that's a powerful theology, but it's a cold word. On the other hand, when you see this creche before you, and you're all invited after Mass to come forward and to say a prayer here before the creche, when you see the Holy Family nestled in amongst the warmth of those animals in that cold Bethlehem night, that touches you in the heart. You know, if you get our parish newsletter, and if you bother to read the front page articles, then you know that for this whole past year, I've been writing about the skeptical Bible reader. But this is not a night for such things. On Christmas, skepticism seems to be out of place, and instead, wonder defines our strange new normal. On your song sheet, for example, you'll see a couple of pictures of shepherds looking heavenward, and they're looking at a shining star. And I almost, when I was putting that song sheet together, I almost didn't use those pictures because they're really not accurate. There is no story in the Bible of shepherds looking up at that star of Bethlehem. The story of the shepherds never mentions the star because the star belongs to a whole other gospel. It's the story of the wise men and the Epiphany, and that's not for 12 more days. That's why the wise men are over there slowly but surely making their way here to Bethlehem. It's two separate stories, but it's forced together, and on a night like this, it really doesn't matter because this is not a time for such details. This is a night that celebrates those feelings of joy and hope and beauty. And in this spirit, one of the symbols that become a part of Christmas, simply one word, believe. Isaiah has been with us throughout the just completed season of Advent. That prophet is much a part of Advent as was the Advent candle and the Advent wreath. And tonight he leaves us with a message that captures the power of that one word, believe. He writes, the people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shone, for a child is born for us. What an understated power in those few words. We don't have to take the prophet's words for any of this just on its own either. We feel what he's talking about. We know that blessed feeling of hope at this time of the year, and we know it firsthand. We experience it. We don't have to only be told about it. And that's powerful because that's a message that we all know personally. In that deep darkness of the world, it has to give way to the light that is shown because a child has been born for us. Jesus comes for us. Now this is so, it's not complicated, but it is compelling. Everything else nowadays seems to be so full of hyperbole. I took a shower twice today, twice, because it's so late. I'm usually sleeping by now. I took two showers today. And when I put on the deodorant says it lasts for 96 hours, 4 days. Do they think that I'm not going to take a shower for 4 days? Why do I need a deodorant that lasts for 4 days? Everything is so full of hyperbole that you have to be skeptical. But the Christmas of the Bethlehem manger that is untainted by these things. A child has been born for us. There's nothing grand in that statement. He wasn't born in a palace. He didn't come with all kinds of riches and power and the whole world stopped. The world went on when that child was born. A child has been born for us and nothing more. And that unadorned birth of Jesus in the poverty of an animal's manger, that somehow pushes back the deep darkness of our world with his light. This revelation is so countercultural that it's actually confusing. And it isn't said any more convincingly than by one of history's greatest theologians. And maybe you even know this theologian. He wrote, "And the Grinch, with his Grinch feet ice cold in the snow, stood puzzling and puzzling. How could it be so? It came without ribbons. It came without tags. It came without packages, boxes, or bags. And he puzzled and puzzled till his puzzler was sore. And then the Grinch thought of something he hadn't before. What if Christmas, he thought, doesn't come from a store? What if Christmas perhaps means just a little bit more?" And amen. That's all that Christmas is. That little bit more than anything that can be bought in a store. And the last thing I want to say is when they were setting up this brand new Christmas tree, thank you very much to the Fosters who donated it. They gave me a toy. I have a little toy here, a remote toy. And as they were setting it up, they kind of thought that I was going to, well, I have a toy, and so I have to use a toy. So I can push a button. Look at that. I can do that. Ooh. And then I do it again. And wait, hold on. Oh, I broke it. Hold on. No, I should be doing something else. Hold on. There. Look at that. Amazing. So I got my little toy, and they told me I got to do something with it. So I'm thinking, it doesn't matter the color of the lights. It doesn't matter if they stay on steady. It doesn't matter if they blink. Nothing matters except that they are the light. And when Jesus comes, all of those different lights, each one of us, we're all a little bit of that light that Jesus brings into our world. And thank God, we're all just a little bit different. It doesn't matter if we're the white lights or the colored lights. It doesn't matter if we stay on or if we blink. We are all part of that Christmas light that Jesus brought into the world. And our job is to bring that light from here, where it's safe, out to where it's needed. Because you know as well as I do that this is a mean world. And Christians are now needed more than ever to be that light out in the world. And that's why every single Christmas, I bet you for 25 or more years, we always lead here to the strains of joy to the world, because that's our job, to bring that joy, that light, from here out into the world. Because God left all the glories of heaven to be born like this. And that's a message that has to touch us, and not only touch us, it has to motivate us. Because he is the light, and now we're the best chance he has of shining anywhere beyond this building. So a Merry Christmas to all of you. A blessed and joyous Christmas, and may the message of this child fill your hearts, your homes, and hopefully through us, all of our world. And these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. So since I got a toy, people, you like that? Or do you want that? You like that one? Yeah? Keep going? No? You like it?
Oh, don't tell me the blinking one.
The blinking.
No blinking, no blinking.
Blinking and flashing.
You like really the color?
That one.
All right, everybody, this is the Democratic Church. Raise your hand if you like the colors. Oh, geez, we're going with white. One person likes the colors. Okay. There. Oh.
Oh, oh that's perfect.
Uh-oh. No, we're all set. Thank you. Thank you.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Almighty Lord, as we begin our celebration of the Nativity, the birth of Jesus amongst us, we ask, Lord, that his joy and his hope and all the goodness that he brings into our world, that it may fill us and hopefully through us can reach out to this church and to the people who need it most. We ask you, Lord, to bless each and every one of us here gathered, to hear all of our private prayers that we bring before you, to hear them and to answer them as you know how best to do it. We ask this in the name of Jesus our Savior by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us
sinners now and at the hour of our death. Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
In
the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, but one being with the Father. Through him all things are made, for us and our salvation. He came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in fulfillment of the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit.
Comes to govern all the earth, to govern the world with justice and the peoples with faithfulness. We receive from your most sacred hands, O gracious Father, the sacramental bread, the same faith entrusted to the apostles and disciples of your Son and our Savior. When he sent them, I myself am the new bread come down from heaven. If anyone eats this bread, it shall be forever.
That glory, Lord God, you choose to be guaranteed.
brothers and sisters, that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Amen. Eternal Father, accept our gifts on this joyful feast of our salvation. By our communion with God made man, may we become more like him who joins our lives to yours. We ask this through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Jesus Christ our Lord. You sent us Jesus Christ, who conceived by the Holy Spirit, was born of the Virgin Mother, Mary, most holy. We have come to know and love you as our perfect Father through the revealed mystery of your incarnate Word. We praise you, Father, and through your Son, now made visible, long to be with you, our unseen God. Therefore, the angels and archangels, with all the saints and the entire church, we lift our hymn of praise to your glory, repeating unceasingly. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We therefore, most merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, most humbly beseech you to accept and to bless these gifts, these holy, unspotted sacrifices, which your holy church receives from you, pointing to defend and guide her throughout the world, together her priests and all true believers of the holy faith. Remember, Lord, your servant. And all present in this congregation, imbued with faith in your holy care, your rule and fatherly love, wholeheartedly this night, we unite in spirit with all of them, beginning the most blessed Mother Mary, Mother of Jesus Christ, likewise his apostles, and all the countless hosts of martyrs and confessors who lived, labored, and suffered for the same holy cause which Jesus Christ sacrificed his life and his most precious blood, just as they believed, professed, and united with you through prayer and this immaculate oblation, which you have instituted from the beginning of the world and in time have fulfilled through Jesus Christ, and gave it to humanity as a pledge of eternal salvation. So we too this night profess and unite ourselves with you, most gracious Father, in humbleness of spirit, and accept from your hand this holy bread and this precious chalice as a longed-for gift bestowed on us by the Savior of the world as spiritual food and drink. He promised us this food and drink in that moment when he revealed his divine power by the multiplication of bread and feeding with it a hungry multitude of people. Afterward, he foretold giving of that food and drink to his disciples and friends as it were excellent nourishment when he said, "It is my Father who gives you the real heavenly bread. I myself am the living bread come down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he shall live forever. The bread I will give is my flesh for the life of the world." And afterwards, when the temporal and messianic life of the divine teacher and giver of the covenant was drawing to a close, he gathered into the upper room all those he had loved in a singular way and had chosen to continue his work of salvation. He spoke to them words of deep love, longing, and resolve. "I will not leave you orphaned. I will come back to you. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Do not be distressed or fearful. You will suffer in the world, but take courage. I have overcome the world. If you live in me and my words stay a part of you, you may ask what you will, and it will be done for you. Anyone who loves me will be true to my word, and my Father will love him. We will come to him and make our dwelling place with him. I consecrate myself for their sakes now, that they may be consecrated in truth, that all may be one as you, Father, are in me and I in you. I pray that they may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I living in them, you living in me, that their unity may be made complete. Father, all those you gave me I would have in my company, where I am to see this glory of mine, which is your gift to me, because of the love you bore me before the world began. I myself am the bread of life. No one who comes to me shall ever be hungry. No one who believes in me shall ever thirst. And after these and other words of the archpriestly prayer, and with holy fervor, our Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and having lifted his eyes to heaven, to you, his almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which is given for you. In like manner, after supper, taking this excellent chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again he gave thanks to you, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which will be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. We, your servants, as also your faithful people, in remembrance of this Christ, your Son and our Lord, as well as his blessed passion, resurrection, and his glorious ascension, we receive from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. These gifts we receive with a joyful countenance, as from him who is the giver of all temporal and eternal good gifts, with an unshakable faith that they will become for our souls a saving remedy. We humbly ask you, Almighty God, to command that our offering be brought by the hands of your holy angel to your highest altar, into the presence of your divine majesty. That we who receive the most sacred body and blood of your Son from this altar may be filled with every blessing and grace, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and who have passed on to eternity. To these souls, Lord, and to all who rest in Christ, grant everlasting life. And to those that are in life straight from the path of righteousness, unmindful of your fatherly love, mercifully shorten their suffering. We ask this in the name of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs and all your saints, who shed their blood for your name. Their hearts are always open to justice and mercy, and with lives patterned after their divine master, merited eternal joy. Number us in their company, Lord, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. By whom you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and freely give us all these good things. Through him, and with him, and in him, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. Forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us pray, instructed by our Savior's teaching and following divine example, we say with confidence,
yeah.
all evils, past, present, and future, and by the intercession of the blessed and glorious Mother of God, Mary, together with your blessed apostles, Peter and Paul, as also Andrew and all the saints, grant us peace in our days, supported by the help of your mercy, may we always be free from sin and secure from all disturbance. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
May the union of divinity and humanity in Jesus Christ bring us sanctification and eternal life. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world,
grant us peace.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Do not look at our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom. For you live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit, your death brought life to the world. By your holy body and blood, free me from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me faithful to your teaching. Never let me be parted from you, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. May the partaking of your body and blood, Lord Jesus, not be cause for my judgment. Though I am unworthy to receive this great sacrament, through your loving kindness may it become my safeguard and healing remedy. My saving master awaken in me a living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. Through this communion, make me your willing servant, zealous to fulfill your holy will. May it at last unite me entirely with you, my Lord and my God. Grant this who lives, reigns with God the Father, in unity with the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. I will take the bread of heaven, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to everlasting life. Amen. What shall I return to the Lord for all the graces that he has given me? I will take the chalice of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. With high praise will I call upon the Lord, and I shall be saved from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to life everlasting. Amen. To take away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Body.
Please.
I begot you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God our Father, in receiving your holy word and his holy Eucharist, we rejoice in the birth of our Savior. May we share in his life completely by living as he taught us. We ask this through the saying of Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Oh, the sacrifice is offered.
Thanks be to God.
May the tribute of our worship be pleasing to you, most holy Trinity. Grant that the sacrifice which I, though unworthy, have offered in the sight of your majesty be acceptable to you. Through your mercy may be effective for myself and all of those for whom I have offered it. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Almighty God bless you. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was in God's presence, and the Word was God. He was present to God in the beginning. Through him all things came into being, and apart from him nothing came to be. Whatever came to be in him found life, life for the light of men. The light shines on in the darkness that did not overcome it. There was a man named John sent by God, who came as a witness to testify to the light, so that through him all might believe. But only to testify to the light, for he himself was not the light. The real light which gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and through him the world was made, yet the world did not know who he was. To his own he came, yet his own did not accept him. And he who did accept him, he empowered to become children of God. These are they who believe in his name, who were begotten not by blood, nor by carnal desire, nor by man's willingness, but by God. And the Word became flesh, and made his dwelling among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory of an only Son coming from the Father, filled with enduring love.
Thanks be to God.